Let's see what the Delphi participants in the study of 2017 had to say about cultural change. I think, Hans, you were there as one of the 50 experts. So what you see here is a cause and effect diagram, which we made for all 14 of those. But this is for number three. And this was set then in a smaller group setting, talking about, okay, so cultural and behavioral change is number three. And why? What are the reasons that we see why that is an important innovation area? There's also some stuff below in this diagram, which isn't shown now, and let's keep it that way, which says, okay, what are the consequences? But let me walk you through this. So from the left to the right, why don't people change? Well, there is no motivation to change. And why? Well, they're too busy, work pressure, or they would like to change, but they don't have the freedom to act. Why is that? Well, if you then take another step, well, there is conservatism with management, said this group. And the management is not really keen on actually having many changes. But there's also, as you see below that, there's conservatism with employees themselves. They also are resistant to change. What you then see coming in a number of areas, people have not grown with developments that were once in the periphery and now are core. It's like this notion of smart maintenance, of digitization, of the more proactive maintenance, the predictive maintenance that used to be something that somebody did in the corner. And now it's becoming more and more the normal way of doing business. And people haven't grown with those developments because they're not motivated, because they're conservatives, because they don't have time. And then it becomes difficult, of course, to make the change if you do not have the skills to make the change. It's not just the people to the left, to the right, says it, also the organizations that do no longer fit with the new needs. Why is that? Well, there are changes in priorities. So what was a good idea 20 years ago no longer is that. It's difficult the way that we structured organizations is in functional silos. It's different to look around that. It's also because our management is focused on those functional silos. We have the focus of management on functional results to the top. And in general, because of all this conservatism at management, there is not a really big priority with management to change culture. So management is really the bad guy in this story, it sounds. But that's also us then as well. So this is what was said. And let's not over-exaggerate. This was a half an hour discussion, I think, of what are the reasons, what were the reasons with this subgroup that discussed the reasons behind culture and behavior change still not making a lot of progress. Yeah, well, there's a lot of stuff there. What is less spectacular, of course, if you don't change, then you don't improve to the left hand side. If you don't improve, there's discontent with progress. What you then get is, it's not yet the post-Trump United States with a big gap between two different countries, or two different groups in the population. But there is a gap between the believers and the others. People do not move on. There's little out-of-the-box discussion. Basically, since things don't improve, there's no new way of working, you get accidents, you get suboptimal performance. So lots of bad stuff. Okay, let's skip this one. And now the question to you, dear experts. What is missing here? Or what is just wrong? Or what is really on the money? What can you say to this diagram? Or what is it that strikes you? And it's a free for all now. But of course, if you let's say that if you want to say something, somebody else is speaking, then please use the hand tool to raise your hand, as Niels has already done now. So Niels, you're first there.
Just to kick off. So I recognize, you know, a lot in the diagram, if not everything, but that doesn't mean that it is all correct in a way. I think it's a good representation of how we tend to think about these things. So if we think a change is due and it is not happening, someone must be blamed. So people are conservative, or they don't want to change, or they are resisting, or they Maybe, you know, it's more productive to think, you know, if we think a change is necessary and it's not happening, maybe we are doing something wrong. And so maybe we haven't, you know, given a clear reason why this is good. And maybe we are not consistent enough. Maybe, you know, we say one thing, but we, you know, reward something else. That happens a lot. Or maybe, you know, we have built a reputation as management that we want this, we want to go in one direction one year and in another direction the other year. So I would say a healthy starting point would be, you know, these people who we expect to implement changes are not crazy and they are not lazy. Most of them are not. And yeah. So if it's not happening, no, we should look beyond just the easy explanations that, you know, well, they are resisting and they are conservative. Just as a very general starting point.
And a good one too. So if I understand you correctly, say, well, this is a bit of an us-them diagram where us, we know what needs to happen. We need to change in a certain direction. And them, they don't want that, and because they're conservative and short-minded and they don't want that. Whereas you could have more an endogenous view of, well, perhaps, well, they may be right and we may be wrong, or perhaps there are things that we are doing that makes it more difficult for them to join. That's sort of, I suppose, the more sophisticated view of things. Yeah, yeah. Who can build on that and say, well, that's all very nice, but, or I recognize that, but.
I would like to. I agree with Niels in terms of leadership is often a word what's used, and leadership is different from management in my perspective. As an example, what we did at a project, for instance, is we built a leading coalition with people who really were enthusiastic about this change and wanted to cooperate. We built pilot, we took them with us and we educated them. They were real, becoming real ambassadors for the change. And but after a while, some managers, their managers, were not fully engaged, and they did not get enough time to be still on board in that project, because they were also expected to do all kinds of other tasks in parallel with it. And they didn't bother at first, because they said, okay, we do it because we like the change and we are still on board. But once we cut a little bit further, they say, yeah, but we are not awarded for this. We only get paid for what our regular job is, but we do not get any award from management for this special thing and this extra effort they did. So then you need to address management again and look for the leadership to overcome such hurdles. And that's what we often see. And it's also a process which needs to be guided by kind of a maybe a change agent type of thing. So that there are also very good process guidance in the change itself. So otherwise, you lose that type of momentum again.
Yeah. Corinne, you would like to add to this?
You have to have a goal with someone who stands for it in the higher regions and be consistent in it. I always tell my people, we are on a journey. We know where we're going, but the path is difficult. And we try when it's a good trail we choose. We stand to it and we make it a new standard. And we take the next step to our goal. And every time a step failed, we do not step back. We take a step aside. And so we're going on a journey with the whole group. And in the first, they say, oh, it's failed. We're going back. No. It's failed. We've learned. What is our next step? So you must do it really together, and you must be consistent, because it takes 3, 4, 5 years to
But go. Karin, isn't that then in itself already a certain kind of culture where it's okay to make mistakes and okay to screw up and then we take a step back and what have we learned, rather than blame people for the mistakes they made? And isn't that already in itself a different kind of culture, although you're also working towards a more proactive culture and a digital culture, etc.?
Yes, because also in the management, they collect failures from it doesn't work, we have to go back. I said, no, it doesn't matter, it doesn't work. We explain, we experiment, we make a new decision, but it must go to the point that the vision we have. We never step back. Because when you do that, it's also in the culture a reason for let's try and it will fail and we will go back. Eh? We bend a little and then we come up again.
Yeah.
It's also yes, failures are okay. Failure is learning, because I don't know the way either to our vision. We have a strategy, but maybe we have to change our strategy. Know that and be open with it.
Yeah.
Then you go on a journey with the whole people.
Yeah. So it seems that there are cases in which cultural change is, well, not easy, but it's successful. And that's especially if there's no other way, because people are leaving, or it's required by law, or we have an epidemic and it has to happen. I've also recently had several good discussion with companies that all of a sudden now can use augmented and virtual reality and servicing of their machines with customers, whereas the customers before didn't want it. But yeah, now if it takes 10 days to come somewhere and you're not allowed, then having augmented reality glasses is better than nothing. So those, I suppose, are the easy ones where it's clear that because there's no other way.
What yes, about but if you look to that, Hank,
okay,
if you look to that, Hank, we saw that a figure was focused on culture change or attitude change.
Mm-hmm.
But I think if you are in business, you don't achieve nothing in the business if your focus is only on culture or attitude change. Your business is to achieve something about, if you look at assessment, if you look to asset management in about reliability, so you can produce more or you have lower costs, something like that. If you put the examples you put in there, is what was not the goal to achieve a change of attitude, it was to achieve and more capacity or in hospitals, exactly, or something like that. So you don't have a goal to change the attitude. It can also say you have to, you have a main goal on your business, of a main objective on your business, and then some sub goal could be changing of attitude, changing of culture, be there because this contributes to your main goal. I think you need the main goal, and then you can say, okay, what do we need to contribute to achieve the main goal? That could be some kind of changing of your attitude.
I completely agree. So it's not a laag pour laag. It's not change culture for the fun of changing culture. It's because you want to go somewhere. And so far, the way that people behave today is stopping you from going there. But going there is a business goal, like more reliability or the lower costs or higher safety or whatever. And for in order to get there, a subordinate goal is, then people have to behave more proactively or more consciously, or they have to make a change in their behavior. But the behavior itself isn't the goal. I completely agree.
Maybe I could respond just very quickly to what Corinne said. I think that was a really important thing. And that is that every change process you know, we would like, you know, that we have improvements from the start on, but very often that's, of course, not the case. And so you are used to a particular way of working, and then you start changing that, and that very often means that, at least in the short run, the output is worse, your results are worse. So then it's really important that you don't, you know, give up and, you know, say, okay, apparently it doesn't work, we go back to the old way of working. You need to have this clear goal, and you need to be convinced that ultimately that actually will pay off. So that is important. But there is something going on there that can be quite problematic. And that is that we also have a preference in change programs for quick wins. So one way of keeping a change process going is to show quick wins. But the reality often, of course, is that you actually can't promise that, because you know that you will go through a period that maybe, you know, processes actually will be worse in order to reach a point where they will become better. So I would be very interested to hear how the people from the companies, whether they recognize that and how they deal with that.
Yeah. Well, I think several can contribute. I was thinking of Roland, because Roland has one of his cases where the goal was to implement some condition monitoring on a very complicated piece of equipment. And actually, a few of the first predictions were just wrong. And now I'm still, I still would love to understand why, despite the fact that these things went wrong, costly, dangerous, etc., people still continued in this new way of working. Can you shed some light on that, Roland, or are you as puzzled as I am myself?
No, I am. But this is not really a direct answer to the preference for the quick wins and how to continue a change program. If you, yeah, maybe it is. Let me start by I was interviewing the people, the different stakeholders who were involved in that case, the implementation of a new condition monitoring technology, and everything was new and it was complex and it was a very critical piece of equipment. But first there was some reluctance to change from some people to actually perform the measurements. So technologically everything was in place, but the people were not willing to invest some time that the machine could be running to perform additional measurements, and then to so you have better insights in those machines. And while having the interviews with those people, it actually made quite sense. Like, it's not that we know best and you should be doing this, but from their perspective, they were just focused on, all right, let's produce here this machine. These are my KPIs. I need to produce as much as possible, so please let me do that. Plus, they had some bad experience with this type of measurements in the past. They even sent some notes about it, some official statements that, all right, we're not going to use it because in the past it didn't work. Now you're expecting me to give up some of my time. This is not the way to do it. But the reason that in the end things worked out here in this case, because management said after a while, this is what we're going to do. It was pressure from higher on saying this is the right thing to do. And even they accepted that there was a learning period in here. The condition monitoring specialist, for them this technology was new as well, and they derived the data, but they didn't really know yet what it meant. So I see some deviations in the data, but does it also mean that it's going to break down soon, or is something wrong? Is it not wrong? But they were quite open about that, and they didn't recommend maintenance actions in the beginning. In the beginning, it was just the verification, right? We don't know exactly what it means, but let's inspect, let's find out. All right, let's perform an extra maintenance activity. We know it costs some money, but then we learn better how to judge these things.
So again, management then.
Yeah, there was a management decision that, all right, from this moment onwards, we're going to do it. This is because the people were not, they didn't have any influence over each other. It was just, you have the condition monitoring specialist and the people within the factory, and then there was no formal power or anything. So it required management there.
Thanks. That remains an intriguing example. Who has some more examples of those quick wins and how they help or perhaps not help, Corinne?
Yes, we have now, as I said, 8 plants, and every plant had its own culture and own difficulties. So we started with plant where we could win at most, the most. And it was a small group, familiar group, and they had also younger people that want to be better. So we started with the first plant, and then we do the next plants. So when the next plants maybe had got more difficulties, their colleagues took them through it because they've been there. They've seen that and they got solutions for themselves. And that's always better than when a manager at a high tower say what you had to do, while you in practice sees most different things. So the colleagues with each other, they made the culture.
Oh, and by the way, there was management saying it's a good thing that you do that, eh? Because you were there.
Yes, of course.
We were not enough.
Not without the management, but it's also management. How do you work with that maturity model in your organization?
What I also like about that this example is that, of course, Niels didn't mean that, but this is how I heard it. Say, here's the short-term, quick win, but it's sort of opposite from the structural long-term improvement. Perfect. You're almost... I almost heard him say, and if you do the short, quick fix, you actually make the long term more difficult. That's, of course, not what he said. But so it suggests that there's some either or, either the quick one. But what you're suggesting is, hey, here I can do 8 things. They're all sort of similar. Let's take the area where it's the easiest. If I have to cross this river, let's take the place where it's less deep.
Yeah, and the rest will follow.
Yeah,
because the leader... Of course, you have management, but informal leadership is so important in an operational organization. Never neglect that.
Yeah, yeah. Somebody else wants to say something about this? Else, I have another question. You're ready for my other question. How quickly can it get bad? And is there a difference there? You know that that there is, it isn't a real old saying, but nowadays in Dutch it's being said that trust comes on horseback, comes on foot but leaves on horseback. As I said, I don't believe it's an official saying, but nowadays. So could it be that, so we talk now about improving things, making things better, and that the role of management there and good examples. Does it only take one or two managers to turn a good situation also to threats? Is that more difficult, or is it the same? Is it symmetrical? Who can share some? So we talk about from okay to good, now about from good to not okay at all. Hans, from your wide and decade-long experience.
What in industry, what we often see is that the lifetime of a manager is about 3 to 5 years. And then the tendency is that...
you mean in a job, eh?
In a job, eh? Yeah. So they come in, they need a year to learn what it is the job, what do I need to do, how are the processes here, what do I need to improve. They start improving and then... they look for quick wins and also business cases with a year or 2 year payback time. Otherwise, they say, okay, it's not my problem. It will be the next manager maybe. So saying that, it means that what Corinne just mentioned is that leadership management is very important, but you also need that informal leadership, but it's often a kind of setback every time when a new manager comes in. And in industry, I think it's more than in other, I'm not sure about that, but That's and if there is nothing in the company which has say, okay, this is what happens when we do that, and then what you see, it goes up and it goes down, it goes up and it goes down, and then people start saying, okay, we did that before, it didn't work, and all that type of stuff. So and then after 3 or 4 times it has been tried, then the next manager has a hard job to bring that in again or bring that up again.
Yeah, I think Niels has broad experience in other industries as well, where this kind of thing happens. I do know from my own experience, it's with the military, you know, they even have 3 years, so there you only have 12 months more or less to get something done, and they have to get something done. But and at maytime, not make too many enemies, because else you don't make general. But also many administrative civil servant settings with the politicians coming and going, you know, that we even have series about that. Yeah.
So what sometimes helps, we have some good examples that you do it by a technology push, as I call it, by introducing a software system or something like that.
Yeah.
And you say, okay, this is the new way of working. Now you have to. And sometimes people start or keep up complaining about SAP or something. But in the end, when you look back, there was a big improvement compared to the situation before. But that is hard to see also for people sometimes working with these systems. But then, so it's all what you need to be aware of when you start changing, of course, as a leader, you need to. Exactly what Corinne also said, you need the mission and the vision and see what is the best strategy to change. Is that doing by learning, or is that a hard push because of we don't have time enough or not that much time? And designing a change is always a difficult word. I think Niels will not like that word, to design the change, but then he, but you have to be aware of that type of stuff to be successful.
Yeah, indeed. And I like the comparison with IT, because I, in my own background in the electronics industries, etc., and also in ERP implementation, we often called it the concrete. IT sounds really intangible, but it's often the concrete that you pour over a way of working, because if it's in the workflow in the IT systems, then certain types of behavior become pretty difficult. Niels is there, but I certainly also want Kees to comment on this also from his broad experience. I'm also interested in Kees, in you worked at several companies. Where, for instance, this idea of IT systems that help or limit change, especially if we talk about planned change, and then a good way of planning it, as Hans suggested, is, okay, let's make sure that we implement these things also in new ways of digital collaboration. Could you tell us a bit more about your experience in there?
I think if you go to the example of Hans, but also to the example of Roland, they talk also about the IT systems. One is about condition-based monitoring, the other is more about the ERP system. So I think if you are changing the structure and the system, then you will change also behavior. There's one part of the 5th to 5 box also is about structure and system. So I think it will be changed also. And if you see examples enough, I think it's not examples special for asset management. If you see the upcoming period of the last 10, 15 years about smartphones, and I think nowadays we're using smartphones still more also for asset management, you see some kind of changing. Is it a planned change? Not really, but you can use the change also for asset management process. If you make apps, I think you see also apps for iPads and for tablets you can use in inspection, that kind of stuff. So do we see change about it? yes, we should change about it because people like to do use some parts of applications. You see, could if you see to we have some kind of management of change tool. I think the first one was some kind of paper system. The second was for the half paper, and for the half it was something useful, not SAP. And the last, the next one was complete use of based on SAP, but was about a web application based on SAP. And the last one is also a web-based application, also about SAP, but it's really good, smooth. And then they make the last one, web application, also available on smartphones and tablets. Yeah. So also the use of management of change will be make it easier to make initiate MOCs, but also to follow up the MOCs in their environment. So if you look at the attitude change, that is also, is the plan change? I think it's more about how can we improve the process of management of change, and partly of that is also the change in attitude of people.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks. Yeah, indeed, the mobile phone is a good example of how sometimes that may not be a planned change, but if it is, then you can definitely utilize it for smarter ways of in this case maintenance. Niels, you had you raised your hand earlier on.
Yeah, no, I just wanted to respond to Hans, and I completely agree. Of course, when you change a culture, you need to have an idea where you're going. And anyway, also what Kees just said, I mean, it's never a goal in itself. So you're not, you're not starting to change the culture because you have nothing better to do. So you want to let's say, and implement another, system of doing maintenance, which in many cases will imply that behaviors need to be changed. And maybe, but that depends on the magnitude of the change, let's say, in your maintenance systems, maybe you also need to change some attitudes, and maybe you even need to change the culture. And so if that's necessary, if we're really talking about a big change, then of course you need to know where you want to go. But I would say you also need to think about the process of getting there. And I think that's not very different from what Corinne already mentioned, but I just wanted to emphasize it. So it's not enough to have a clear picture of what you want to, where you want to be in the end. You need to also think about how to get there. What are the activities that are necessary to get this process going and keep it going in the right direction? That is, I think, also, it's something. And maybe that's of course, attention from managers or leaders is very important, but we also have to recognize that not every manager is really good in doing this. Many of them are really, very content oriented, are more technically oriented, and they not always have a kind of a natural, affinity with these more behavioral things. So in that case, they might need some help.
Yeah. Yeah, that's not for everybody, indeed. The manager is a beast with many different qualities.
Yeah.
I would like to make a final round by now.